Okay, so we start. This is about the second part for related to polymer models for chromosome. So I had the cold this weekend and there's also some fever, so I don't feel very well. So forgive me if I will not be too precise. So in the first part of the things that I described to you last lesson concerned some models that were proposed in the, let's say, in the course of the years, and that we somehow we named looped model. So namely, at the basis of let's say of the description of chromosomes by using polymers, that the fact that you have polymers where there is the probabilistic formation of some loops, okay? And the presence of those loops is necessary to describe the experimental data. So I don't know if you have questions about that. Okay, if not, we move to the second part. This division in models is not really sharp. It's more like to make an order on all the models that were proposed in the, say, in the course of the years. And also because there are different physical features that at the basis of these models. So the next topic is related to the role of topological constraints in the folding of chromosomes, so in chromosome conformations inside the nuclei of the cell. So what I mean by topological constraint? So topological constraint is something very simple, so to say. So suppose that related to this is topological constraint for polymers and for chromosomes. So suppose that you have polymers in solution. These things let's say just move the kind of way we saw last week, and then it happens that there are these fibers, the polymer fiber, the chromosome fibers that come close to each other, and then they bump into each other. Okay, but because of this bumping, what it happens that they cannot, it happens of course, you can expect that they cannot cross each other. This is a let's say an important ingredient in polymer solution, the fact that you cannot cross the two fibers which are close in space. And then this constraint, of not crossing, imposes certain rules of what you can expect for polymers and for chromosomes as well. Okay, so the idea, let's say the topological constraints and the importance of topological constraints in polymers, let's say, has been pointed out since the very early days of polymer physics. The idea that they are also important from chromosomes instead is much more recent. To my knowledge, the first work that pointed out on the importance of topological constraints for polymer, sorry, for chromosome, was this work by Shura Grossberg and his collaborator, where they proposed, this original idea of the fractal globule. So what is a fractal globule? A fractal globule is, if you want, a globules of globules of globules. So namely, it's a very simple idea. It's a sort of, it's a polymer, with space filling. Namely, you have, so the polymer lives in a volume. All the sides of these volumes are occupied. So it's in jargon is what is called an Hamiltonian walk. So basically, it's a space-filling curve. So all sides are occupied. And it's not self-crossing. So it's self-avoiding. So it's not only self-avoiding, but it's also space-filling. Okay? And further ingredient is that what is closed in space, sorry, what is closed in sequence is also closed in space. So namely, you have to think in this way. So suppose that you have a lattice. It's a much. Okay. Then the crumpled globule is done in this way. So, namely, you have portions of the chains which are, let's say, closed in the sequence. They are also closed in space, and they form, let's say, crumples of increasing scale. So it's a fractal object. Okay, this curve has one important feature that does not form knots. Okay, this is in 2D. There are never knots, but suppose that you have it in 3D, of course, because we are talking about, 3D. I mean, we are talking about chromosomes, so we are in 3D. They never form knots by construction. And suppose that you pull from one of these ends, you can, let's say, open it very, very easily, because there are no, basically, there are no, since there are no knots that can be detrimental to the swelling of this chain, then you can open this curve, very, very easily. And this structure was proposed in the end of 80s, in order to model chromosome. But why was proposed, this kind of model for modeling chromosome? Well, the idea of these guys was, okay, chromosomes are very long polymers, right? And if you have topological constraints between close base chain, they can be detrimental to how chromosomes work inside the nuclei of the cell. So this kind of structure can be, let's say, much more efficient to ensure the proper functioning of the chromosomes in vivo. Yes.
Why
is
there no
notes? Well, it's a bit by construction. No, Hamiltonian walk. There are two things. So this is an Hamiltonian walk, mm-hmm. Okay? Hamiltonian walk by construction are space filling. It's the definition of an Hamiltonian walk. But on top of that, this construction does not have knots. So because you have to imagine, it's a bit. This is on a lattice. Let's do it in the continuum, so that we build something this way, and you have a sort of first crumple, then you have a close by crumple, okay, and you have this way, and then and that was how it was imagined in the original work, okay. So, of course, in 2D, you never have knots. In 3D, you can. Even for a Hamiltonian walk, you can have knots, no?
So, in 3D, you can have...
Yeah, even for a Hamiltonian walk, yeah. This is a sort of a restricted class of a Hamiltonian walk, if you want, okay? So, now, the question is, does this thing has any relevance? How about topological constraints in chromosome, and if they can be measured? So that's not easy, of course. Okay, and it's a bit an indirect measurement. But actually, in yes, this is a 3 because it's space filling. Okay. Yes.
What is the dimension of them?
In 2D, it will be 1/2. In 2D, will be 1/2. So the fractal dimension of this object is 1 over D. Sorry, is D. Okay, so if you want, this is a polymer, so it grows always like n to the nu. Okay? Yeah? In this case, nu is equal to 1 over d. D is the dimension of space. And the fractal dimension of this object is df is equal to 1 over nu, so is d. The fractal dimension is defined as the number of components that are contained inside a region of size R, no? So then n is proportional to R to 1 over nu, and then the fractal dimension is 1 over nu. Okay? And this is a real fractal in the sense that this, this exponent is... it holds at each scale. I mean, until you reach, of course, the total size of the object. But I mean, yeah. Okay. So let me see. Yes. So up to this work, let's say that was more like a theoretical speculation than real. I mean, there were no, that was published in a physical journal in the 80s. There were no real data that supported this idea at that time. So, but then it came out this work in the later, I mean, in 2009. Actually, this work was the original work of about IC. I mean, this technique that I mentioned to you, I mean, a few days ago, last week. So, in this work, the authors pointed out that in order to explain their data, so they needed to use the crumpled globule to need to explain their experimental data. So, as you can see, that was achieved much. Let's say 20, so the confirmation of this model appeared like 20 years later. What they did, sorry to go close here. They did a simulation like a Monte Carlo simulation of a polymer model, and they simulated two different ensembles. So one ensemble was compatible with an equilibrium globule. An equilibrium globule is very different from a fractal globule. Equilibrium globule is basically a globule where you allow local chain relaxation. In particular, you allow for basically chain crossing and knotting. And so the conformation, it appears like this. So if you color like a rainbow, the polymer chain, you can see that all portions of the chain are completely mixed. While if you simulate a fractal globule, you obtain a structure. I mean, if you still rainbow color your polymer fiber, you can see that different colors stay together. I mean, they stay spatially close to each other, and they are, let's say, like separated in space, or if you want, they are, let's say, they belong to different regions of your globule. What's important, I mean, because you mentioned the fractal dimension, I mean, there is a very specific point to address, is that the equilibrium globule is very different from a fractal globule, because the equilibrium globule has a fractal dimension of 2, because locally it's like a random walk. I mean, on small scales, it's like a random walk, okay? While a fractal globule has always a dimension of 3, I mean, you know, at all, I mean, in all, to all scales. And then they compared So why they simulated the crumpled globule, they resorted to this model? Because there were, as I said, there were experimental data. And the experimental data are the following. So what they measure are contacts. As I said, they used, that was the original paper they were introducing HiC. So then they measure contact frequencies between... is 3. How can it be fractal in three dimensions? Well, it's a fractal of dimension 3. It's a space field. Well, okay, it's a special fractal, so it has dimension 3. Can be, no? Why not? No, not necessarily. I mean, it can be, but that's a special case. So that's a real fractal in the sense that it's it always look the same. To, I mean, it's a space, yeah, it's scale invariant. Okay. Maybe the dimension is? No. The dimension is the inverse of nu, because it's defined like. So you need, so you define a region of linear sides R, right? And you ask how many, I don't know, how much mass I have inside, right? So, and then that's n to the, like, df, R to the power df, and then df is 1 over nu. Okay, but why, as I was saying, why they, let's say, they resorted to this model? It was because they had this experimental data. So what they measured there, if you remember about this IC technique, so they measured contact frequencies between, inside the genome of a human cell. And in particular, they were able to, I mean, after they measure all the, let's say, all possible contacts between all possible chromosomes inside the cells, they were able to measure what's called the contact frequency between, let's say, between those selected spots on the on chromosomes as a function of the genomic distance between these spots. Between two, basically, you have your chromosome here. You can measure how frequently two sites interact as a function of the genomic distance L between them. And they average between all chromosomes, so they did really a sort of ensemble measurement. Okay? So this, if you want, is the same as the return probability. So this is for a random walk. If you had a random walk, that would be like 1 over L to the 3 over 2 in 3D. But what they found from the experiments is the following. So this is the curve you get from the experiments. And they found a region, this one, between which is about between 1 million base pair and 10 million base pair, whose slope is not, let's say, is not 1.5, but it's about 1, okay? So it's something very different. And so then they made this hypothesis that maybe it's not, let's say, it's not an equilibrium problem. This is a very good model. This is a good model for the chromosome, but it has to be something like the fractal globule. Because if you measure the, so then what they did, they simulated the fractal globule, and then they measure the corresponding contact frequency between the simulated model, and they got a slope which is about minus one. I mean, it decreases the contact frequency as one. Providing, in some sense, the first experimental evidence that chromosome can indeed be reasonably well described by this kind of model. Okay, so that was the first experiment. Let's say the first experimental. Sorry. Yeah. Of this kind of model. Yes. So the different color. Yeah, it's a kind of way to show different regions. So you have your polymer fiber, yeah, right? And you start coloring it like rainbow coloring. So you start from, so you see, I don't know if you see. So you have your, so from the last, so that's a linear polymer. So that's the first monomer and the last monomer. So then you start like red, I don't know, green, and you all do this way. And the reason to do that, I mean, it's just, it's not nothing so special, but the reason to that is the following. To make evident that regions which are close in sequence, for the fractal globule, are also close in space. So you see, so they stay together somehow. While that's not the case for the equilibrium globule. So okay, maybe here it's not super evident because I think the polymer they simulated is not enormously long. You would see much better result, of course, for very long, for much longer polymer. But I mean, it's kind of evident. Okay. And so why they simulated, so how they simulated this is, well, it's a bit technical, but if you are interested, maybe you can ask to me later. They use the, anyway, they use Monte Carlo simulations of a polymer model. But I don't want to go too much into this detail. I want to more to talk about different stuff. So the role of topological constraints seems to be very important, as I said, for because in the end it seems very important, it seems to all actually well describe the situation, I mean, the kind of physics or biology that you have for chromosomes. As I said, that was done for, that's for human chromosome, mammalian cell. Of course, I would expect the same happening the same for other kind of mammals. And in fact, the people, they measure they used high C for other mammals, and they found very, very similar results. I mean, for these contact frequencies and so on and so forth. And I think, I mean, the next few days, Mario Nicodemi will tell you, I mean, more about that. So now, actually, the role of topological constraints to describe, let's say, the physics of a chromosome is important not only for eukaryotes, like us, but it's also important in prokaryotes. Mm? So that was, I mentioned to you this because I think it's a very interesting work. It was done, 2006. So this model was introduced by June and Mulder to describe, let's say, the separation of the two different newly formed chain of DNA after the application, I mean, in E. coli, in Escherichia coli, so namely in a bacterium. So the E. coli, as I said, I mean, maybe I mentioned to you last week, contains only one single chromosome of 1 million base pair, roughly, made of only of DNA, so it's much simpler than eukaryotes. But it's, it applicates very fast, so it's, let's say it's one of the most studied, probably, organisms in biology. And what it happens, I mean, one critical question for it is how, I mean, what are the physical mechanisms that, that lead to the formation of the two new cells? And the way these people model this, so basically what you have is the following. You have one single chromosome. So then it starts to duplicate. And the duplication, it happened, it's like, so basically you have one structure of this thing that is called, you have a spot which is called the replication fork. And here, this is the single filament of DNA, and here you have two new filaments of DNA, this and this one. So it opens like this. So it duplicates in this way, okay? It's very simple. So then, at a certain point, they will stay linked for a few time, for a very short time at some point, and then they separate, and they go to those two separate parts of the cell, and then the cell can duplicate, and then that's it. So you have two new cells of E. coli. Hmm? So in this paper, these guys have actually simulated the process of duplication. Hmm? So they used, again, they used some Monte Carlo algorithm. So they had one single polyp. So they really started to simulate the process of duplication here. So they doubled, let's say, the content, if you want, of the polymer, the polymer content inside the simulation. And actually, they came with a very beautiful results because they show that only... So they didn't have here any specific cellular, I mean active mechanism, or like it was just pure polymer. So if you have one polymer, you start with a second polymer, start introducing more and more polymer just to simulate the application. And what they found at the very end is that the two chains separated, let's say, spontaneously. Okay, so. That was a very nice result because it showed that basically the separation of the chromosomes follows from the fact that you have repulsion between two close by chains. Repulsion and, that's very important, the fact that E. coli is, the cells of E. coli is elongated, is a sort of a tube, okay, is a cylinder almost. And they show that having a cell conformation this way helps in separating the two chains, okay? And they show this by Monte Carlo simulation, and they show that also that so they had also some mapping to real time. So they show that actually this mechanism is compatible with what you observe experimentally. So this is just to show you another, in this case also, there are topological constraints between these chains, because these guys, actually, they never, so they really simulated this process. So if you think a little bit, during this process, you also never have the formation of knots again. So in a sense, the role of topological constraints here is a bit similar, it's similar to what you have also for the crumple gob. It's not exactly the same, but it's somehow similar. And it shows to you the importance of this ingredient for the description of, let's say, for the physics of chromosomes inside the nuclei of the cells. And it's okay, this is E. coli. So I'm not an expert of E. coli, so I want to tell you more about that. But it's important that you know that people have analyzed also this kind. So they've applied polymer physics also to this kind of to this kind of organism, which are somehow are simpler, of course, than eukaryotes. Okay, question. So thing this I want to mention to you. This was my work, but I think this is maybe I mentioned to you later. What I want to say to you is the following. So there is a general question here. So what told you so far concern models where we have neglected the heterogeneity of the sequence. What I mean is the following: DNA chromosomes are not homogeneous polymer, right? I mean, you have the sequence of DNA, you have histones, which are not regularly placed inside the chromosome. So it's a very heterogeneous polymer. So it seems a bit strange, I mean, that you neglect such kind of ingredient in your modeling. Okay, there are features which appear general, which, like for instance, the contact frequency, the slope that is compatible with MANOHOOD 1, as I told you, is general, so was found also for other mammals, so it's seems a common feature, but there are other features which are not so general, so they are specific of the organism. So in order to model it, you need to introduce models where you have sequence heterogeneity. So you have information of related to the specific sequence of the chromosomes. So now this is a very, so if you do that, I have to say that the task of simulating chromosomes becomes immediately very demanding, okay? Because, okay, as I told you, first of all, chromosomes are very long polymer in general. So if you also introduce the sequence heterogeneity, so then you introduce, first of all, you have to establish how you want to introduce it, to relate it to what kind of problem, which kind of problem you want to address. But introducing it immediately makes the problem much more demanding from the computational point of view. So this kind of technique, so this kind of modeling can be done only for simple organisms, or so far, at least it was done to the best of my knowledge, or to single chromosomes, to model single chromosome, for instance, for human or for Drosophila, because Drosophila melanogaster is the fruit fly, and there's a genome which is big but not so big, so it's an intermediate genome. So its genome, the genome of Drosophila is, it's about 20 million base pair, so it's not as big as the human one, but it's still quite big, to simulate. So this work, the one that I want to mention to you, was done, proposed a few years ago in the a group of Christophe Zimmer at Institut Pasteur in France. So what they simulated here, they proposed them actually a model, a whole chromosome model for yeast, Saccharomyces cerevisiae. Why this? Because yeast is, as I told you, is an eukaryote, but is a very simple one. So its genome is very small, so then you can simulate it. You can simulate all the whole nucleus of Saccharomyces cerevisiae. What they did is the following. So they introduced a model for chromosomes here. So this is their model confined inside their spherical region, which models the nucleus. And they also introduced a specific feature of Saccharomyces cerevisiae, which is the presence of nucleolus. Nucleolus is a region within the nucleus, the physical conformations of, not physical, I mean, yeah, the physical conformation of chromosomes in Saccharomyces cerevisiae are the following. So all chromosomes are attached here to a region which is called the spindle pole body. So they are this way. And here there is a region which occupies a large portion of the nucleus. 25% of the nucleus, more or less, this one. And this region is the nucleolus. And it faces, I mean, it's on the opposite side with respect to the spindle pole body, okay? So now, so this imposes a strong constraint, I mean, on how, I mean, on the regions, of, I mean, on the, let's say, on the regions which can be occupied by chromosome, no? Because basically they have all these regions. I mean, they do not penetrate. A nucleolus is formed, actually, is formed by, is a, the nucleolus is formed, is also formed by DNA, by some sort of chromosome, but they belong, so it is formed by, only, by, it's formed by some regions, which are at the end of some chromosomes, and, so this, if you want, imposes, so the nucleus is this one, is this sort of sausage-like region, this one. And so it's made by some portion of DNA which is more compact, more, let's say, which has a thicker size compared to the rest of the DNA inside the cells. So they imposed this constraint inside their model. And so then they did... they simulated this model. They used here, they used the molecular dynamics simulation. And what they found actually is quite remarkable because also here apart from these effects which you want are still extruded volume effects, so in the end are not biologically related, they are just the kind of ingredients that you put in a normal, if you want, the polymer model. They compared their results to the experiment. So they basically they mapped their region to real biological region, and they found that the spatial positioning, this is the comparison, so this is predicted and this is measured. They found that the kind of prediction of the model works rather well when compared to what they measure in experiments for some region. So these are some specific regions on the chromosome. This is the spindle pole body. So the so these maps are called how do they call them? I think they're called like chromosome charts. I think something like that. Basically, is a two-dimensional. The two-dimensional chart is like a map, and the different columns are related to the density of the spot that can be detected. Okay, so this is the spindle pole body. As you can see, also the spindle pole body, of course, moves. This is CEN4, is a specific region on chromosome. Yes, on chromosome 4. These are the telomeres, the ending of chromosomes. And this is ribosomal DNA. The ribosomal DNA is this one, is the one that is associated to the nucleolus. Hmm? So you can see that the model, I mean, is simple, right? Because because it's only physics based, is able to reproduce experimental data quite well. And they also compared contact frequencies between loci measure and predicted from high C experiments, because there are also high C experiments for yeast, and they found that the agreement is quite good. Okay, so this is just to give you a flavor of what you can do for modeling. They are like self-avoiding chain.
But space-filling or just...
No, they are not space-filling. No. Do you have... they are not because the density is... I think it's about 10%, 15% for in a saccharomyces. In general, the density of DNA, well, density of chromatin inside... the nucleus of the cell is not high, it's about 10%, something like that, okay? And this is the same here. For in general, this is a number which is more or less the same for any eukaryotes. The only, actually, I have to say, the only ingredients that so there are two main ingredients here. The with exception to this part, which is the part which is related to the nucleolus, they are the chromosomes. They are different colors, but the chromosomes are always described by the same model. It's a self-avoiding polymer model. Then one end is attached to the spindle pole body, and the other end is free, with exception of some of these ends which form the nucleolus. Okay, which is modeled as a sort of thicker polymer, is because this is what people know from the biology. Okay. And apart from that, then it's, let's say, it's basically polymer physics in the sense that then you have, you measure what, because then they did it, so they applied the molecular dynamic simulation to this model, and then it's, and then that's it. So in the sense that you don't have any specific interaction. You have some specificity in the sequence, but you don't have any specific interaction. It's just extruded volume, okay?
So one should have expected equilibrium slope of
1.5. Exactly. In fact, econometrici revise, okay, many possible reasons for that, but it's a sort of an exception. So, saccharomyces cerevisiae has a slope which is more compatible with 1.5 than with 1. Mm? And this is probably related to the fact that chromosomes of Saccharomyces cerevisiae are very short. They're not long. I mean, very short in the sense that the average, so the genome is very small, but in the average Saccharomyces cerevisiae chromosome is about 500,000 base pair compared to the average human chromosome, which is 100 million base pair is much shorter, and this is probably a possible reason that it gives you this slope. I mean, people are really discussing this kind of slope a lot. So probably tomorrow Mario will tell you also more about it. You always also to be a bit careful in the sense that. So this is this. I mean, from the polymer perspective, measuring a slope, it gives you just one single exponent, okay? But one single exponent does not identify a model, because you need more exponents, possibly, to identify a reliable polymer model, because so basically the exponent with which the contact frequencies decrease is one, but and this probability is not related to the exponent 2. So you should, in principle, have a technique which measures also the exponent 2 in order to be more quantitative on the polymer model, at least to decide to choose that I want this and not this. But unfortunately, by high C, you cannot measure this exponent 2, okay? So. Of course, I mean, the fractal globule is very attractive because, it's, as I told you, it's a model where closed portion of the genome are also, portion of the genome which are closed in sequence are also closed in space, and you can really imagine to pull one strand after the other, and that's possible. So it's... topological constraints are much less detrimental than for a model where you have everything mixed together, okay? So more recently, this is a work by Daniel Jost, Cédric Vaillant from the Ecole Normale Supérieure in Lyon. So what they did here, so they sort of introduced a model. So as I told you, as I was telling before, so if you introduce a sequence heterogeneity, I mean, the model becomes quite complex. So what they introduced here was a model to explain some data for Drosophila melanogaster. So the model is the following. you have a polymer model, and then it's always, I mean, polymer, it's a sort of Bidenspring polymer, so it's the standard polymer description. But now, the exception is the following, that you have five, if I remember correctly, uno, due, maybe four. Okay, it's not important, maybe four. But what's important is the following, that you design monomers, so it's a sort of copolymer. So you have four different kind of monomers, okay? So you can imagine to color each one of these monomers along the chain in order to describe different states of the chromatin. Now, I mentioned to you which these kind of differences are. And then you have a preferential interaction between regions of the same kind. So, namely, blue and blue region like each other more than blue and green region, and blue and yellow region, and blue and black region. Okay? So that was their idea. So, this kind of model is not new from the polymer physics point of view, in the sense that it was introduced, many, many years ago, in order to describe the physics of, as I said, the physics of copolymers. And what these models, so if you simulate these kind of models, so by molecular dynamics or Monte Carlo or whatever, end up, so the let's say, that depends a bit on the temperature, okay? But in general, what you see here in this kind of model is what's called microphase separation. So, namely, regions which are, regions which like between themselves, like the blue and blue region, tend to form portions which are segregated with respect to the yellow one, which are also segregated, between themselves and the rest of the polymer. So this phenomenon is called microphase separation because, the reason for calling it microphase is just jargon, but it's because this phase separation happens within the same, within the polymer, okay? You would have macrophase separation if, for instance, you have two polymers, or a solution of polymers, with two or more species of monomers. Just to mention you why this is called microphase separation. So now, why they introduced this kind of modeling was because they wanted to describe DNA of chromosomes of Drosophila, which, let's say, people found people found basically that they could be described by essentially four epigenetic states. So you know what's epigenetics? So epigenetics is a sort of new frontier of genetics. The sequence of DNA. You think that everything is related to the sequence, which is transmitted to the cells, blah, 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 blah. Okay. So that's true, of course. But there is also something which is called epigenetic. So epigenetic is the kind of, modifications of DNA, our DNA, which cannot be transmitted to the offspring, but which essentially remain within the same organ. And this is due to the fact that DNA goes into some transformation during its life. So, for instance, this is because DNA interacts with some specific proteins during the course of our life. So this epigenetic mechanism actually affects continuously the life of all living beings. But they cannot be transmitted to the cells simply because you are not going to modify the sequence. You are just going to modify the chemistry of of the DNA. And this can be done, for instance, by some processes which are called, for instance, methylation, acetylation. So these processes are going just to modify the chemistry of the single base by modifying, for instance, the interaction with histones. And of course, they cannot be transmitted because you are not changing the sequence. But you are changing how the DNA works. And of course, these so modification by epigenesis is okay. This happens continuously, but it's not always positive because also, for instance, some cancers, for instance, are due to epigenetic modifications of our DNA and also DNA of mammals or other species in general. Okay, so can be dangerous. They are not like mutations because again, we are not changing the sequence. They are just changing, if you want, epigenesis. Are just changing the chemistry of DNA. Hmm? And so now people, at least for Drosophila, a group of experimentalists has observed that they associated basically two chromosomes in Drosophila. They looked at the chromosome in Drosophila and they saw that the chromosome can be roughly divided into four epigenetic states. So basically the DNA has some, so they identified some chemical state, and they can be, so basically they made some clustering, if you want, and they asked, and they saw that there are only four relevant states. One they called yellow, active, green, which is associated to the presence of some proteins along the sequence of DNA, which interact with DNA. Then blue, which is a polycomb, is a species, is a kind of, is also a protein, which is essential for the functioning of Drosophila. And then black, which is repressive chromatin. So chromatin who is going to repress, the expression of DNA. So, and the idea of this model is that all these regions, so it's an hypothesis, of course, all these regions prefer to interact between themselves, but not not across themselves. So this is their result. They measure different things. They saw, as I said, microphase separations. So, namely, for instance, the black and the in this case is orange, but okay, the black and the yellow region stay physically separated, and they form a microphase, and they were also able to compare this model to experimental results. So let's see. Yes. So this is the experimental results, and this is their model. Of course, they knew from the biology where, how to position their on their model, their different monomers, and then after they did it again, they did a simulation based on Monte Carlo, I think. They were able to compare with experimental data, and they found a remarkable good agreement with experimental data. So now they had a model that, at least for this specific case, is going to work to describe very well the. Let's say, again, it's still a bit the physics of the chromosome because it's always a polymer model, but with sequence heterogeneity. So, do you want, yeah? These diagrams. So this one, you mean? So this diagram, so let me see. So these diagrams describe so the contact frequencies between the different regions. Okay, so the reason why, for instance, they appear like a chess pattern, these I think now I don't remember how to say, but this appears, I think this is because at the beginning the conformation are very ordered. This is for the, probably for the initial conformation, then they become disordered. For instance, okay. So, let's start from this, which is simpler. So this is for the random coil. So random coil is just a random polymer. Hmm? So you can see you have the diagonal is red, means that you have all your interaction are confined to the diagonal. Hmm? And then that's it. This one? Yes. So this is the experiment. Yes, this is the experiment. Yeah, you have cluster, yes. So this is a specific feature of contact frequencies in general. This is for Drosophila, and this is an experiment. So what people... it's for experiments, yes. No, I'm not sure if this is an experiment. I think it's possible that this is experiment, this is the simulation. But okay, the message is that they look similar. Okay, let's go maybe first to experiments. So this is what people observe in experiments. So you have, okay, your main diagonal. This is always observed many diagonal because things which are close in space which are also interact much more. And then you have like sort of squares. And these squares are region where you have preferential interaction between, let's say, chromosome fragments. Hmm? And of course, this thing is not trivial because then, because this thing is reproducible. So that means that it really is really telling you something about the biology of the chromosome. So then they use this model in order to see if they could reproduce this result, experimental result, and they did it remarkably well. So this here is instead because say in their model actually you have a sort of so you have many possible states that depend a bit on the temperature. Mm? So you have the coil, then you have multistability, namely you have things which are still so you see these things are still very so they start to basically to collapse because they have the same color, but they are not really forming anything so compact. Instead, here you have something which resemble, which is much more compact than this thing. So, so what they observe there is that you have the participation of all these possible states. Then, according to the temperatures that you are investigating, you have some states which have higher probability than the others or not. But in general, all these states participate to the phase diagram of your model, okay? A question? You want to do a small break? Okay, then we do a three, four minutes break here. Okay, so the models that I have presented so far. Can be categorized as a sort of direct modeling. So what I mean is the following. You have your polymer models with some kind of hypothesis, about your model. For instance, let's say the one for yeast with the presence of a sausage-like region. And then you use, you implement this model in some sort of simulation routine, and then you get the results. So this is kind of what I would call direct modeling. You have your polymer model with some hypothesis, and you get the results, and then you compare to experimental data. Maybe if it compares good, then you have done good from the very beginning. Otherwise, you have to refine your model somehow. Mm? Otherwise, there is another approach which has become very popular recently, especially in connection with this contact map, is the following. You use, similar, I don't know if you're familiar with that, but a bit similarly with the idea in proteins. People have used NMR, especially NMR data for proteins. to reconstruct the 3D conformation of proteins. So they use the NMR data as a spatial constraint, and then they use this data to reconstruct how the protein looks like in space. So this is a similar idea that you have here, I mean, that you have also for chromosomes. You use the contact between that you can measure by HiSeq in chromosomes, and you do an inverse modeling, namely use these as constraints, and you reconstruct the chromosome conformations inside the cells by using this data as inputs. Of course, I mean the two. So this is not. I mean, the two approaches are not unrelated in the sense that you can use a specific polymer model with spatial constraints in order to reconstruct the chromosomes. But there are also other approaches which are a bit different. So that's why I was mentioning to you these. So the first attempt, in this respect, was done in 2002, where when people proposed, let's say, the very first version of HiSeq at the time was called chromosome conformation capture 3C. So what people did there, they used the spatial constraint. Sorry, they used the data that from 3C as spatial constraints for a model, which was not a polymer model actually, was a sort of so was something very simple in the end. So you have different. So this is the matrix of constraints. This matrix appears so it tells you which is close to which for a system of coordinates. You divided this by squares in squares, and then you associate. So and then you derive. So you say that D, for instance, one is close to, I don't know, three, and then you use what is called distance geometry, which is a sort of routinary tool to reconstruct three objects in space starting from some constraints, and then you get this shape. This thing was very simple because in the end, here you don't have too many constraints because this was done for East, and so again, was very short. In the end, they were able to reconstruct the shape for this specific chromosome, which I think was the chromosome 3. Yeah, chromosome 3 for East, which appear like this. So in particular, they found that the two telomeres, so this part and this part here, were found relatively close in space, which is also something which is known from the biology. So in this sense, they were able to find back a result which was known from biology. So now with the new HiSeq technique, things become more complicated. And so one has to reconstruct. First of all, one has more data, but having more data means that you need to satisfy more constraints. So the thing is, so computationally, this task becomes very demanding. So this paper was published a few years ago. It was about the complete reconstruction by using HiSeq data of East genome. The reconstruction they get, so because of the, I mean, from this reconstruction, they found many results that were already known in the literature, but proving that reconstruction can be an efficient tool to get back chromosome, I mean, to get back the shape of chromosome and the shape of the genome by using HiSeq data. So in this case, they used. I think they use a sort of polymer model. So, what I mean is the fact that you have all your chromosomes, and each chromosome is a polymer, and then you implement the constraints there. But that's not the only approach. There is other kind of approaches. For instance, this one, where they used a tool which is not based on polymer. So namely, you have just beads, let's say, in space, and then you implement the constraints on these beads, but it's always by using high-C measurement. But these beads are not, let's say, even if they are on the same chromosome, they are not linearly connected. So these, I mean, to me, looks a quite strong assumption, especially because then in the end, you want to, you want to retrieve that monomers which belong to the same chromosome, they have to stay close in sequence. So apparently, I mean, if you read this work, they were able to find that, at the end. But they did not put that as an input. So basically, they did not use polymers. They just used disconnected beads. And then they implemented the routine in order to reconstruct some specific locus on the human chromosome. So why they used these things which, maybe can look a bit strange, no? Why don't you use a polymer model and then implement in a polymer model spatial constraints? And the reason is why, actually, they used a tool that was basically developed for proteins in order to reconstruct the 3D shape of proteins by using NMR data. So it was kind of, let's say, improvement of this numerical tool applied to chromosome. In that case, there were no, implementation of the fact that different monomers belong to the same chain, so they have to stay linearly connected. And that's the reason why they did not use that. So probably, I have the impression that this kind of tool can be used only for very short fragment which where they implemented it on the chromosomes. But for longer, if you have, let's say, genome-wide measurement and you want to satisfy those constraints, I think you need to use a model where monomers, which belong to the same chromosome, they have to stay linearly connected. Otherwise, I think you never, it would be very difficult to, I have the impression, to satisfy these constraints. Sorry? You can use, sorry, what?
Machine learning algorithms.
Yeah, maybe. No, but that was already done a few years ago. Yeah, sure. Actually, I didn't put that here, but there was a paper published, I think, last year. They did not use it for chromosome reconstruction. They used machine learning to apply it to high-C data to derive a sort of effective force field between monomers in a polymer mode that become then compatible with the data in order to simulate chromosomes. And they found that, I don't remember, they found that, so you have a sort of, you have, I don't know, 10, I'm saying some number, but I think it's this order. So it's about like 10 monomers, 10 different kind of monomers with different interaction potential. So it's a bit similar to the kind of model I mentioned to you before, this copolymer model. But that was derived directly on the data by using on the high-C data, and they used the machine learning to learn this force field. Okay, but it's a different story, so they did not use for chromosome reconstruction. Actually, it's a bit more kind of a polymer model. Yes, and this is... this is a similar work. Actually, they used a very similar tool where they reconstructed, but at much using much more coarse grain. So their monomer, one single monomer, it's much larger because they wanted to try reconstruction of human chromosomes here. So you need to be more coarse grain, otherwise that will never work. and already like this is very demanding. And so this is just to give you an idea what people can do now. So to conclude, I want to just to mention to you the very last thing. I mean, how also polymer dynamics, and namely the Rouse model, can be relevantly used to model instead chromosome dynamics, which so far we have not discussed. So this is all about, chromosome conformation. So in space, but chromosome dynamics is important as well. So this is this is a bit of blah blah blah. So you remember, but the only thing important, no? You remember that the Rouse model gives you this behavior, which is subdiffusive. And this is in general for any polymer model, even if you apply the Rouse model, but to a self-avoiding polymer, you still get always subdiffusion. So this is because of how polymer relaxes from small scales to larger scale. So now, there are many, many experiments on polymer dynamics. I just want to highlight this one, was done on yeast. It's a very recent one. It was quite remarkable because they can follow so what they did, they tagged a specific, many specific locus, but I mean, different loci, sorry, on Saccharomyces cerevisiae for different chromosomes. So these are the loci they tagged. And then they follow the dynamics of this tag in time. So they were able, so you can really see them, no, like with a camera. And so they were able to reconstruct their XYZ coordinates, okay? So from the coordinates in time, they measure the mean square displacement of these loci in time. So you can really measure the dynamics. And this is their results. This one. And apart from the noise, I mean, of course, you have always have some noise. They found that the dynamics appears, remarkably were described on average by the Rouse model. So this is precisely the same quantity that I mentioned to you a few days ago. So the mean square displacement of a single monomer, and they found that the exponent of the mean square displacement is about 1.5, which is very close to the expectation of the Rouse model. So you don't. That means also that probably you don't need something too sophisticated to describe the dynamics of yeast in the cells. For human things, it could be probably more complicated. There are other results, but I think I don't have the time to mention this. But it's very interesting that by using a simple model, you can have you can reproduce the data. But in the end, the Rouse model is very simple. I also want to let you know, maybe notice also that the curves stay, for different loci, seems to stay on top of each other. So that means that there is some kind of, you can use just one single model, no, to describe all these data. So it's very, yes. This one? Yeah, this is the mean square displacement, so it's over time. And this is, it goes like t to the 0, t to the 1/2. Okay? So it's sub-diffusive. All the time up to where they were able to measure it. Yeah, it means up to that about 500 seconds, which and scales here up to 0.4 micrometer square, which is what is 0.6 micrometer, which is quite long. As a scale is not. It's quite remarkable because the total
So the, let's say, the total, the linear size of a nucleus of yeast is, let me remember, is about 2 micron, so the diameter, 2 micrometer, okay? So, I mean, the average size of a nuclear, of the nucleus of the yeast. So, we said that these things is following dynamics up to scales of 0.6, about 2 micrometers, which means that, it's a, oh, no, not the half, I mean, it's, it's 1/4 of this, no? So it's quite long. So then you ask what, why they didn't follow, they didn't went farther. Well, the problem that with this kind of experiments is that there is a phenomenon which happens at late times, which is called the photobleaching. Photobleaching is a kind of, so basically you start to see everything white. I mean, everything appears white. Well, while that's why called the photo bleaching. And that's a kind of problem which is perfectly known in this kind of technique. Sooner or later that appears, and then you cannot visualize things anymore. So then that's why they stopped here. Probably, I mean, with improvement of technique, they can go farther. Of course, I mean, if. But that's quite, actually, it's quite remarkable as a measurement, especially because they were able to, for almost 4 order of magnitude, a bit more than 4 order of magnitude, which is quite an achievement. Okay. And then I would just to, you know Monte Carlo. Okay, no, I want to just to conclude to tell you which because probably it would be a bit useful for what Mario wants to tell you tomorrow. So, which kind of tools you use for describing chromosomes? Well, basically, since these objects are quite complicated, you have always to resort to numerical simulations. Okay, so there are. Hope it's not mine. So there are two kind of molecular simulations, numerical methods, which are Monte Carlo or molecular dynamics, or both. I mean, you can use even both. So depending what you want to do, I mean, you can use one or the other. Who of you are familiar with Monte Carlo or molecular dynamics? All. Okay, good. So I want to tell you, so then I don't go into, because I explained this to biologists, or to what Monte Carlo is. So of course, I mean, but you are not familiar with Monte Carlo for polymers. No, okay. So Monte Carlo, so just a simple example. So Monte Carlo for polymer, of course it depends on the problem again, but to give you an idea, and to explain things in an easier way, I'm just using a polymer on a lattice, because in the end, if you have enough, I mean, if polymers are long enough, it's not important if you're on a lattice or off lattice, and you can always move from lattice to off lattice. So the most, the simplest example are of course the random walk and the self-avoiding walk, because they are also the two simplest polymer models. So how you do? Of course, for a random walk, you don't really need simulation because you can do everything exactly. But okay, yeah, let's do it nonetheless. So, how you do random walk on a lattice? This is a 2D lattice. It's very simple, no? You start from, a node of the lattice which you call the origin, and you move randomly in one of the possible directions. Then you move on the other. So you use. So for doing that, you use some random number generator, of course, and that's it. Actually, what's the main feature of the random walk is that even if you fall on a site which is occupied, you don't care. I mean, it's okay, you, because it's a random walk. So this is called simple sampling, because you are generating all conformation independent from it, from one another. It's a very simple algorithm. I mean, it's really two lines of algorithm. And for a random walk, is okay, no? Because it's very simple to write, and that's fine. For a self-avoiding walk, of course, you can still use the same kind of algorithm, which is, again, it's called simple sampling. And you can do the following. So you go, so you start from, again, from the origin. Then you move this way, this way, this way, this way. But then it happens that if you do this thing here, so if it happens that your next move, your next step, let's say, fall onto a site which is already occupied, then what happened, I mean, in order to generate the right statistics, is that you have to reject completely this walk, all the walk, not only the last move, all the walk you have to reject in order to generate the statistics correctly. Okay? So, this is a plot, just to show you that things work well. This is a plot for the end-to-end square distance of a self-avoiding walk, of a random walk. Sorry, a random walk and a self-avoiding walk. Random walk is in red, self-avoiding walk is in green. And then you can see that the end-to-end square distance grows as is expected to be. Actually, the random walk, the self-avoiding walk is a bit down, probably because it's there are no, I didn't use too much statistics. And the problem is that I used simple sampling for generating self-avoiding walk. Now, simple sampling becomes rapidly inefficient to generate self-avoiding walks in this way. I mean, already for self-avoiding walk of 30, about 30 steps, basically, you never, I mean, almost never generate new walks when you do the, your simulation. This is because you have a lot of crossing in your walk. So that means that the simple sampling is not a very efficient tool to generate self-avoiding walk. Fortunately, there exists, I didn't mention that to you. Oh, sorry. Ah, yes. So fortunately, there exists much more efficient method. Sorry, I didn't have the time to talk about that, but if you are interested, I really suggest to you to look at to this review by Sokal, Alan Sokal, which is called Monte Carlo Methods for Self-Avoiding Walking. This is all for data, I think it's always, it's almost in, I mean, every data is for 2D, but of course you can use the same algorithm for 3D or other D walk. It's a very good review. It explains very rigorously all the alternative methods that were devised to produce in an efficient way in self-avoiding walk. And I think it's very important because basically self-avoiding walk, it's the basis for any realistic polymer simulation. Yes?
Can't you use exclusion principle rather than completely rejecting the whole walk?
Mm-hmm.
Can't you use exclusion principle, like don't go to the site if it is occupied previously, take other possibilities, like the main exclusion principle?
Yeah, but then you need to use a different, I mean, there is an algorithm that which is called PERM, Prudent Rich Rosenbluth Method. What's happening? And this method actually works precisely a bit in this way. So anytime you fall into a site which is already occupied, you just reject the last one and then you select another one until you go into direction, I mean, where there is no occupation. But in order to use this method, you need to reweight your walk, your walks. Okay, so, and then you need to use different weights for it. Okay, this method was proposed by Rosenbluth and Rosenbluth in the, it's a paper published on Journal of Chemical Physics, it was in the 50s. So it's a, or maybe later, no, probably it's 50. And there was a sort of method to use so do not discard completely all walk, but then you need to introduce some weights, and then you have to reweight your walk at the very end in order to get the right statistics, because otherwise you don't get the right statistics. You can try, I mean, but you don't really get the right statistics. Otherwise, you need to resort to method, which two methods that use real Monte Carlo, in the sense you devise some moves which can be more or less efficient in order to simulate the self-avoiding walk. And that review is really brilliant. I mean, there is a lot of information. And also for people who are more mathematically skilled, it proves a lot of theorems saying that these, I don't know, scheme is ergodic, so it proves the ergodicity of some moves. So it's so if you like this kind of things, I think it's a nice reading. So otherwise, there is another possibility, which is molecular dynamics, which is not like more efficient or less efficient. It depends on which kind of problem you want to address. In general, molecular dynamics is useful because you have access somehow also to the dynamics, of course, no, of the problem. Why Monte Carlo? Not really. I mean, you can also do some dynamics with Monte Carlo, but it's much less efficient and less obvious. While with molecular dynamics, I mean, dynamics is immediate. But in many cases, is slower to achieve equilibrium with molecular dynamics. Nonetheless, I mean, it's a very used technique. And molecular dynamics is very simple. From my point of view, it's much simpler than Monte Carlo, in the sense that in the end, it's just the numerical integration of the Newton's equation. Mm? So you have your system of particles, n particle. You have the acceleration, no? And then times the mass. Then you equate the acceleration times mass to the forces. Okay? And the forces, of course, can be very complicated, but are always forces. And then you need to do the integration numerically. Of course, I mean, there is a bit of, tricky parts, because, of course, the numerical integration can be, it's not always trivial. There are different techniques that were devised. This technique is called, so basically, the idea is that you do Taylor expansion on the right, where there are the acceleration, and then you use, the forward time and the reverse, the back time. You sum those together, and then you arrive to see such kind of equations. Mm? So this is a bit of the spirit. In general, it can be a bit more complicated, but not much more complicated than that. This is called the Verlet algorithm. There are other algorithms which are not more efficient, but which are more, in principle, more rigorous, if you want. I'm not going to mention that. This is just to tell you that, in general, this is not so complicated. And then, if you have your forces, in general, forces are derived by some potential, then you need to do derivation of the potential for the forces. For instance, if you want to simulate a Gaussian polymer, what you usually do, you write the equation for the, for the harmonic potential between the beads. So then what you need to implement in the molecular dynamics, not the potential, but it's the forces. So you need to do the derivative of the harmonic potential there. And then that's it. So just to give you how molecular dynamics would work. So this is actually simulation of the paper by Christoph Zimmer, the one that I mentioned to you before. So this is a simulation using molecular dynamics it's very short, but maybe a bit longer. But of the yeast genome. So the sausage-like part, this one, is the part close to the nucleolus, and the other part is chromosome. So this is a very, a small selection of the trajectory, because otherwise, the movie becomes quite heavy. But as you can see, these things, moves somehow. So this is for two different angles, I mean, of vision, let's say. Why? To do this, because you have access to dynamics. Depends when you stop. It depends. In general, okay, this concerns another matter, which is coarse graining of your model. But in general, I would say with current models, they goes, so time scale goes from millisecond to tens of second, real time. So you're simulating real, something like that. But it depends on the resolution of your model, of course. If you are, for instance, if you are not, so this is eukaryotes, but if you want to simulate, for instance, the single chromosome of E. coli, there are people that are doing that, using, for instance, molecular dynamics, then you go to smaller scales because you use a finer model, okay? Because then there you can really simulate the single DNA base pair. Because it's not, I mean, it's long, but it's not super long. It's 1 million base pair. It's not impossible to simulate. While for, let's say, for eukaryotes, even for the simple yeast, it's already quite complicated. And for, I mean, for higher eukaryotes, it's impossible. So this is just to give you a flavor. This is my simulation, actually. This is to simulate the human chromosome. One single human chromosome, and so one single human chromosome, as I told you, this is 100 megabase pair, so I need to do some coarse graining in order to simulate it, so which means that I have thousands of monomers. Actually, I have about 30,000 monomers per one single chromosome, and each monomer is about, so counts about 3,000 base pair, so it's quite coarse grained. But on larger scale, I mean, you imagine that coarse graining is not so. So it means that you can describe only scales from 3,000 base pair up to the scales of your chromosome. But coarse graining, in some sense, is you hope then you have to, of course, to compare to the experimental result. But you hope that large scale are not affected on the level of description that you have a smaller scale. This is a bit the principle of coarse graining. So coarse graining is basically. It's like integration of the smaller degrees of freedom, assuming that and if you integrate out the smaller degree of freedom, you have to just do some normalization, but you don't change the physics at large scales. Well, that's a bit the principle. But you have to do that. I mean, if you want to describe larger structure, otherwise it's impossible. So I think it's about time. So with this, I've finished. So, I don't know, if you have questions. So I sent the slides to Erica, to the secretariat. I don't know if you have received it. Okay, she has it, so she has them. So, yeah. I don't know, if you have questions, otherwise. Yes. Thank you.